Hello, and thank you for tuning in to the Final Draft Write On podcast. I'm Pete D'Alessandro, your host and product manager here at Final Draft. This is the screenwriting podcast where we talk about all things filmmaking. Today's guest, screenwriter Luke Davies, was previously on our podcast to talk about his movie Lion. Today, he'll be talking about his recent adaptation of Catch-22 for Hulu, starring George Clooney, Christopher Abbott, and Kyle Chandler. Here's guest host Michael C. Bryan in conversation with Luke Davies.
Luke, how are you?
Good.
So I have to tell you, it's a real pleasure to meet you and talk with you. You know, I had the great fortune to read Candy. It's extraordinary. I know we're going to talk about Catch-22 because I'm sure that's been your whole life for some time, but your life is fascinating to me.
Oh, I guess.
It's brilliant. You've stumbled towards amazing things. That's just, I mean, fantastic. I have to ask, like, I know you as a poet, you're celebrated and your poetry is lovely. So Candy, like, I mean, I'm going to ask this. Is that based upon some struggles in your life? Because why did you write that?
Yes, Candy, it's very much a typical first novel, you know, in that sense of being a thinly veiled, fictionalized version of real right. events that right. I lived through in my 20s. I had a terrible struggle with addiction through my 20s and kind of wasted close to a decade. Came out the other side of that somehow, touch wood, and began a new life.
How'd you make a peace with that? Because when you say wasted, like, how do you frame it now to know that you didn't waste it? Because look what you're doing.
Yeah, that's a really interesting question. The question of regret versus being at peace with what is and where you are. I feel how I frame it basically is with as much gratitude as I can muster. I still wake up some mornings and pinch myself, even though it's now been 29 years since the day that I stumbled into a treatment center and started to turn things around, since the day I stopped using drugs. Mm-hmm. So I just feel this immense sense of gratitude and good fortune. Mm-hmm. And that's a way of looking at those terribly stupid years without feeling too much regret.
Yeah, I don't think they're stupid. See, this is where I feel you're a soul brother, even though we've never actually met. I really missed in the movie the delicious ways with which they bargained to make peace with Candy being a prostitute for money.
The great moral dilemma at the heart of both the novel and the film, I mean, yes. Obviously the film is Neil Armfield's film, the yeah. director, he and I co-wrote the screenplay.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
The great moral dilemma at the heart of both is this question of guilt, complicity, and the sort of Faustian bargain that Candy and the unnamed narrator, or he's called Dan in the movie,
Yes, that was a fascinating choice, by the way. I love the fact that I kept combing through going, he didn't give me his friggin' name. And I looked at the movie, I was like, you clever man. And it makes sense, you'd have to call him a name. But yeah, so keep going. This is great.
He never got a name in the
book. Yeah, it's very smart.
Obviously, when we were writing the screenplay, we had to give the character a name. We just chose Dan. There was no significance to that choice. That's the dilemma at the heart of the novel. Shame and guilt and how to move through that towards a better life.
Well, shame, right? I mean, shame is always such a big thing. And I love how it sounds like I don't know if we do until we croak, but I love that you've made peace with that. I think shame is very insidious. I think it really gets in there.
Yeah.
And I think the shame about being someone who did something for all the right reasons to feel better, it simply gets away from us.
That's really true.
Right, you know what I mean?
The thing about shame is that it can be kind of repetitive force that keeps you using, you know, because the shame becomes so great that the only solution you can find to deal with the shame is to keep self-medicating as hard and fast as possible in order to not feel the shame. So the shame keeps building and the addiction keeps building.
Gosh, I can't imagine why you're doing Catch-22. Essentially, you just gave Yossarian's sort of whole diatribe right there. What was great about the tenacity and the determination that you have, the resolve, like in The Lion, I really hated you because it was unbearable in the beginning.
Right.
You're a terrible person. It was hard. It was really hard to get through that opening. But then, I mean, how do you find resolve and strength within the pain and the terror? Because you're a man who's not afraid of the darkness. I mean, was the light found in the darkness through those years of using and sobriety, or work, like, because that's your thing, right? I mean, you've got a great gift for that. You know that, right?
Well, thank you.
You got to understand, when I saw Lion and then I read Candy and the stories of their mythology that they created, right, to make it through this, I was like, it's true. what you wrote is very true and real. And that's, I commend you on the authenticity and the lack of ego in your work. It's quite lovely.
Well, thank you. I think it's good for writers to try and find a way of stepping outside of the way that your ego works and into that deeper place where your creativity flourishes better. It flourishes better away from the sort of mad demands of the ego.
You're at the cusp of something. I don't need to tell you this. Clearly, you're a man who you probably could use a little ego, probably a little humble here, but you've been in circles that most people dream about. You've seen things. We've seen things, right? You've come out of their sideness. The gratitude is real for you. It's when I heard about Catch-22, you know, I already knew, of course, about Mike Nichols and, you know, that movie, by the way, I don't know if this struck you, but when I saw it again, I was struck by the photography of it.
Yeah, it's a beautiful looking movie.
It's a really gorgeous film, right? I didn't remember it being so well shot.
Yeah, it's got some lovely shots. That shot with all the B-25 bombers heading off away.
Oh, don't even start with me. When it takes forever until the last bomber goes out of frame, and then you see, then you wait and watch him walk down that thing.
Yeah, it's a gorgeous movie.
Yeah,
it's aged. It hasn't aged all that well. It's got some really, I don't know if it was ever a successful movie. It's a glorious mess in some ways.
I agree.
and it's very much of its time. And if you're mm-hmm. a certain age, you have a very affectionate connection with it and so on. But, yeah. You know, this opportunity to turn it into a TV series, it felt like the right thing at the right time, because mm-hmm. what that incredible novel needed mm-hmm. was the sort of the right canvas to let all this stuff play out in depth and with care and attention and a sort of emotional arc. I mean, you know, there are scenes in the Nichols film where you can tell stuff's been cut. There are scenes where you see Martin Sheen for like 15 seconds and it's like, what? His character, they must have shot more stuff. It's just that it doesn't seem to be in the film.
Yeah. No, you're right. And the strange returning back to the scene, you know, in the novel, it's just so deliciously graphic of the gut spilling out moment and the Assyrians' terror at not having morphine to help that guy, and keep returning back to that, how Buck Henry did that. So, all right. So I'm fascinated by what you just said, the emotional lines of narrative. So how did you, like, it's amazing to me. A lot of people haven't read Catch-22. They don't know it now. They just think that someone came up with a phrase and then they wrote a book based upon it, which is funny. You're right. So how did you approach this in a way, because, you know, Candy is very, the ending is very, I find, very optimistic. He's going off into a bright future. The end of Catch-22, the hysterical running around the door before almost getting stabbed and then being okay versus the movie, which is in, you know. You've always had these disparaging lines of narrative, like you're always about the absurdity. You got crazy in everything you do, which of course enamors me to you. How did you step back from a broader perspective and say, what is the way in which we can, what's the form that we can put this in that makes sense for this structure with Hulu?
Well, I spent quite a few months just trying to work every day, trying to write notes and thoughts and turn and ideas about what a coherent structure might be, what characters should stay. And I literally tore my hair out for 6 months or more, maybe almost 9 months. And in the end, I had this kind of 90-page crazy document, this really, really dense like essay that was sort of like an attempt to summarize a rough structure of the film.
It sounds like what Heller might have done.
Yeah, I don't know what his method was, but to get to that point, the essential thing that I did that was the breakthrough was I worked out the chronology of all the events that happened in the novel. They do in the novel, of course, it's completely kaleidoscopic and out of sequence and out of order. Heller very much controlling the reader, where he wants to take them to the moments of satire and black comedy and so on. My gut instinct was, if we're to make a show that has a sense of an emotional journey for Yossarian, our main character, but for our other characters, his friends, the young flyers who die one by one, and even for the more absurd characters, the sort of heightened comical caricatures like Shyskov, played by Clooney, and Colonel Cathcart, played by Kyle Chandler, that we had to lay it out in order and not just recreate that kaleidoscopic jumble that was the novel. Mm-hmm. And I think essentially Nichols recreated that kaleidoscopic jumble, which was a valid choice, But what I wanted to do was see if we could go with Yossarian from the beginning, from training through to going to Italy and through all the events in sequence with the missions being raised and his frustration and rage and impotence growing, mm-hmm. and see if that could become a journey in itself.
Obviously, I know I'm going to guess here, but why did this appeal to you? Because, you know, we can sit here and break down and deconstruct, because I found in the book, like chapter 39 is where things got really just, my God, it's hard to read.
Yeah.
And then it turns into a whole dark route. And then the hysterical, you know, Heller, I read something before we were going to chat that he was upset that people thought it was funny.
Yes.
Isn't that funny that he was upset by that? I was falling out of my chair reading it again, because it's hard. It's laughing till you can't breathe funny.
The surprising thing is that that's what you remember. When you revisit the novel, you're absolutely right when you talk about chapter 39. Towards the end of the novel, very, very dark.
Oh, very dark. And chapter 39 is nearly impossible to read. I was very upset reading it. I had to stop once, to be honest.
The experience of reading the novel is, oh my God, this book is hilarious. And I had that experience at 16 years old, like many, many people of that generation. It was a school text, had to study it for the final, it was the first novel of the final year of study before the final exams in Sydney. It was called the HSC, the High School Certificate. And so I fell in love with the book. So the experience was like a comet, a meteor hitting you. It was incredible. And I loved it so much. And I read it again in my early 20s. In my late teens, Joseph Heller came and gave a lecture at Sydney University.
Oh, stop. Are you serious?
Yeah, and I lined up after the lecture with my high school copy of the novel and got him to sign it.
That's brilliant. That is absolutely, that's a beautiful full circle thing. So when you met him and you were reading it, were you at that point, if I may ask, were you using it at that point?
19 years old, or maybe 20. I was in second year university studying English literature, maybe third year. I can't exactly remember. Some research would probably tell what was the year that Joseph Heller came to Sydney. I don't know. And yeah, I was starting to head down the slope towards bad times ahead. I made it through that 4-year honors arts degree, but things were already pretty bad by the end of that. Yeah. I was already on that path. And I certainly was never thinking at that moment where I lined up and got this writer who I adulated to sign my copy of the book. I was never thinking of what might eventuate 30 years later. You know what I mean? It was kind of just like...
Well, when the project came to you, did it bring back any sort of full circle moment to remembering when you were younger during that time when things were different and you ran into the book and it meant so much to you? Yeah, talk about that for a second.
It was a really interesting experience. I brought the project kind of into the world in a sense. Richard,
really?
Yeah, the one of the executive producers, Richard Brown, had come off True Detective season one. Mm-hmm. And David Michaud, my roommate and very good friend and co-writer on Catch-22, he and I... Richard Brown came to me and David and said, "Have you guys got any ideas? Let's talk about some stuff. We just created really good television with True Detective season one." And so we had this meeting and Richard had an idea, David had an idea, and I had an idea. And at the end of this meeting, I said, "Oh, I've got one other idea. You know, if I've loved this novel ever since I was a kid, and if we're supposedly in some golden age of television, how come no one's done an adaptation of Catch-22? And Richard and David both went, I think
brilliant.
That's how it all began. Richard went off and discovered that Paramount had the rights and had the rights since the novel came out in 1961.
Really? They've been sitting on it since 61. That's fascinating.
Yeah, they were sitting on it since 61. And then Mike Nichols made the film in 71. And then, believe it or not, little known fact, there was a pilot shot in 1973, 2 years after the Nichols film, starring, oh my God, I'm blanking, you know, wonderful actor, the marine biologist in Jaws. Why am I blanking on his
name? Robert Shaw?
No, the...
Richard Dreyfuss?
Richard Dreyfuss.
Richard? Oh, that's perfect. He's a great Yossarian.
You can see that episode on YouTube. It's absolutely terrible with a laugh and laugh track. So that show didn't go anywhere. They just made the pilot and nothing else happened. Yes, and then they sat on it for another 45 years. Mm-hmm. And then we came along and said, We have an idea. So that's how it all began. And to answer your question, yes, it brought back many, many memories. I tracked down Miss Cogley, my English teacher, and said, you know, remember you taught us Catch-22? I just want to tell you that it's becoming a TV series. And by now, because in the beginning, David Michaud was going to direct the episodes, but he had to drop out because he went off and to make his film, The King, that with Timothy Chalamet that he just shot last year in Hungary. While we were shooting Catch-22 in Italy, David, my roommate and co-writer, was shooting this movie, The King, for Netflix in Hungary and England. And so when David dropped out, there was a moment where it was like, oh, our show just fell apart. And then the very next moment, it was like, oh, Clooney just read the scripts and he wants to do this. And then, of course, everything happened really fast.
Now, he directed some of the episodes too, is that correct?
Yes, there are six episodes. Mm-hmm. Clooney directed two, Grant Heslov directed two, and Ellen Kuras directed two.
Clooney's a great director. You know, I don't think a lot of people are as aware of that as they need to be. But he's really quite, I mean, the people he's, it was funny, I was at the Austin Film Festival talking to Ed Solomon, who did Mosaic with Soderbergh.
Oh, yeah.
And we were talking about Clooney and his directing, and he just looked at me and said, well, you do know who he's been directed by. And I was like, yeah, you kind of, it's like the master class of master classes, you know, this man has worked with. So I have to ask you, because you're the kind of person who is sort of is an amazing example of transformation to me in many ways, because you're very clear, you're very here, you're very present. You created this beautiful life. And do you think that all those years of, as we both agree, that self-flagellation, that sort of awareness but unable to stopness, those years of addiction from all the right places, do you think that put you in touch with something that gave you the ability to have the keen awareness and intuition and sensitivity you do now to take a work as wonderful as Heller's and make it real?
I hope so. I mean, I hope the answer is that yes, through suffering, whether self-inflicted or otherwise, I became better at understanding how the pain and suffering that all of us experience is a universal experience. Yes, and that sometimes in good art, in novels, in poetry, in films, we can alleviate the suffering and enrich our spiritual lives by telling stories about that suffering and about the way we all deal with it.
And I couldn't agree with you more. And I think, I don't know if you feel the transcendentness anymore of Candy, but that's what that book has to it, which struck me. And the movie, the music is quite haunting in the movie.
Yeah, that's a beautiful soundtrack. But thank you for saying that. I remain very proud of Candy.
You should.
Both the novel and the film. It is about compassion and empathy. If you look at the Latin root of the word compassion, if you break it down etymologically, it is com passio, which means with suffering. And it's basically, I think it's through our compassion that we become more human.
Well, that's exactly right. It was like in Buddhism, you know, when I remember I met with a Buddhist teacher and he said, why are you fighting what is? If you stop fighting what is and surrender to it, then you find that your compassion and your humanity is within the suffering.
Exactly.
But I think that's what it excites me about how you view life, is that, you know, the lotus blossom grows in mud for a reason, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. And this is where the good stories are. This is where the stories that matter to me are. How to find those moments of transcendence in this very fleeting situation, this veil of tears, as it's called, which is often fraught with stress and distress and trauma, and yet also hilarity and love and comedy.
Yeah, but you're an eternal optimist, though, aren't you?
I am definitely a glass half full kind of person. Absolutely.
Yeah. That's where you're very lovely, because it's fascinating when I read the more difficult parts of Catch-22 and watching Lion and Candy and all the other work that you've done. I've always noticed this unfettered optimism at the core here that made the darkness is there, but there's always a light around the corner. That's something that, don't you find, for those of us who have suffered a great deal, that is always, like, did you always feel when you were in your late teens and 20s and in that strange mystic place, you know, that misty land of am I here or not, that disassociation place, did you always feel you were going to be okay?
Oh, That's a really difficult question to answer. I think, to be honest, there were times when I felt such a kind of nihilistic despair that I assumed that I would never be okay, but that if I could just survive and attain some kind of mediocre life, then that would be better than this catastrophically bad life. And so, but maybe what that means is that deep inside of me, there was a core little voice that said, there is something else beyond this.
Oh yeah, I think that's your great gift. I think that was calling to you when you were in those places of despair. That's why you didn't end it. That's why you're still here, I think, don't you?
I believe so. I mean, the interesting thing is in the novel Candy, I never really show that this guy has anything going on other than his daily desire to find new ways and means of getting drugs. But in actual fact, the one thing I was doing through that life when I was doing all that was writing every day and believing myself to be a writer. It was not very good and it was incoherent and it was just fragments of stuff and I never got it published. But you know what I mean? I had a kind of some level of belief in what I was. And that belief had started before the drugs kicked in. When I was 13 years old, I read Steinbeck's Cannery Row and it changed everything. It was like, I want to be a writer. I want to make people feel what I just felt reading this book that changed my life.
That's fascinating because I read East of Eden.
Right. That was your Steinbeck moment?
Oh, I couldn't believe what I was reading. I thought, how can every single page be good?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. It was a mind-blowing experience to be 13 years old and accidentally stumble across that book in the school library and to go from reading books that were basically condescending and meant for kids. Suddenly you read an adult book that you just found.
And now you're going to sit here and tell me that you accidentally stumbled onto Cannery Row, really?
Yeah, no. Yeah, well, I was a little, yeah.
Well,
I was,
there's no accident with you. Your life is not an accident. There's been a divine order, I think, whatever the heck you want to call it.
It felt like a beautiful moment of just happenstance, you know, like just wandering through the school shelves and something about that thin little book, pulling it off the shelf and reading it at 13 years old, reading the back cover at 13 years old made me take it out from the library and the rest is history.
Where did you, what town did you grow up in?
Sydney in Australia.
You did. And was it to a biological mother and father?
Yeah. I had a big brother, little brother, and then eventually a little sister came along when I was 10 years old. So it was a little nuclear family in the leafy suburbs. And it was a quiet, pleasant upbringing.
So what drew you to drugs then? But for you, like, what do you think drew you to needing to, I always think there's a good reason why we use to feel better, to feel relief, right? It just gets away from us. So what, I mean, how did that happen, do you think, now that you can look back on this from this beautiful place you're in now?
I still look at this and question this all the time. In some very broad way, I see that what I felt to be an adventurous, you know, you read, you're 13, 14, 15, and you read Kerouac and Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, and it all seems wonderful. But what felt like adventurous, self-defining behavior, like I'm special, I'm different, and I take drugs because it's cool, turns out to be self-medicating behavior in which you're kind of medicating your anxieties. Now, where those anxieties come from is a whole other question.
Where do you think they come from? Because you've thought a lot about this in terms of mind constructs, thoughts, Buddhism, present moment, meditation, all that stuff. Have you delved into that to find out where you think the anxiety came from?
I think I'm still delving into that. And I'm interested in meditation. At various times, I've had various faltering meditation practices, and I continually strive to make that more consistent. At various times in therapy, I've asked these questions that go back into childhood. What would make one person take drugs? The problem is not the taking of drugs. The problem is the moment when you feel, oh my God, I just finally arrived home. For the first time, I feel embraced by some warm thing, force. And then that's kind of how it began for me. But where does it come from? What makes one brother totally not have any issue with drugs and another brother go down the path I went down? I find this an impossibly mysterious question still to answer.
Well, you see, you know, Luke, I don't think it's an issue with drugs.
I think it was your way to lower the resistance to connect with the truth of you, is what I feel.
Right.
And I think there's always this relationship with our younger self, like little Luke, younger Luke, who is always feeling separate, abandoned, disassociated, that sort of thing. That disparaging, that gap thing you talked about that we're all trying to figure out.
Yeah.
The anxiety, I think, comes from that. I think the nature versus nurture is in there. Do you think that's true?
I think that's the great mystery.
I
knew more about whether these things are just in the bones at the mitochondrial cellular level, or a part of what we are, or random coincidence, or deeply a part of the environment in which we grow up. I mean, the emotional, psychological, psychic environment in which we grow up. And to me, it's still the great mysterious question. And I still have no idea which of these things is the dominant thing that shapes us.
I don't think we're supposed to know. I think we're supposed to be eternally questioning, but when we stop questioning, I think that's a problem.
Yeah, it's true. And I also think in some ways at a certain point, your energy is better spent doing your best to be in the present, hence paying attention to meditation and so on, rather than spending too much time analyzing past mysteries.
Well, so how do you take then this dramatic past you had, which resulted in a beautiful dream in Candy? It's just so enjoyable. It's so lovely. It's just lovely. And you also get to the mystery a little bit of life. And I don't agree that he's apathetic. I think he's actually quite driven, but that's okay. I understand what you might say about our unnamed narrator, but I think he's quite driven to life, frankly, as you are. So how do you overlay acceptance of the mystery, but trying to make sense of it, on a novel and now a series that is absurdist by beautiful design, but yet there's still, obviously, a comparison to today, a logical rhythm to it? Did you find that there was a way to answer some questions you have about life and the doing of this? Or was it simply within a setting that's so removed it was difficult to connect to that?
Oh, no, the beautiful, the attractive, one of the many attractions of adapting Catch-22 is the human universality of the story.
That's
and
right.
Yes, the story is pushed to the limits of heightened comedy. It's not a realist drama or a realist comedy. It is an absurdist comedy mm-hmm. to the max.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, the challenge was to try and make Yossarian's moment-by-moment reality feel like a real living, breathing human being who was going through this terrible dilemma about people from his own side trying to kill him because of their bureaucratic rigidity and essential madness. And that the universal experience of that, I think, is really particularly relevant again right now, because we seem to be living in this shed and people, you know, of that thing that Heller says in the novel.
Well, we were talking about Yossarian. So you were talking about Yossarian as kind of being whiplashed here.
Yeah.
And go with that a little, because in Nichols' film, it was Arkin was so incredulous, and so his responses and Yossarian's ways of being in the movie weren't quite what I imagined Heller was doing. So did you find that?
Well, we set out, David and I set out to differentiate, not that we were using the Nichols movie as any kind of reference point. Which
No, it's the only filmed version I've seen, which is why I bring it up.
Yeah, wanted to be different from, but... And Arkin's Yossarian is fantastic, but it's a very acerbic, intellectual Yossarian, a guy who's completely in his head and intellectualizing his experience of panic, fear, anger, escape, and so on. And we wanted our Yossarian to not be that purely cerebral, intellectual guy,
mm-hmm.
but to be more centered a bit lower in his being as a sort of every man who wasn't exactly that cerebrally elevated. And so I was talking about the universality of Yossarian's experience and the way in which it's really relevant right now. Right now, we seem to be living in this kind of shared global anxiety condition in which we wake up every day to see what new mad piece of news awaits us. And as Heller said in the novel, he talks about those in position, those least equipped to be leaders are the men who end up leading. We have a very vivid example of the kind of lunatics who we see in charge of things in Catch-22. Here in this country, there's in the White House, the most vivid example of that worldwide at the moment. But the whole world seems to be filled with these people who are the least equipped to be leading, the most delusional and narcissistic, are the ones who make the decisions. And the decisions that they make, characters like Scheisskopf, the George Clooney's character, or Colonel Cathcart, Kyle Chandler's character, become life and death decisions for the men below them, such as our hero, Yossarian. They are not life and death decisions for the men themselves who make the decisions. These guys are immune from what happens in the real world as a result of their insane decisions.
Yeah, especially Cathcart in the book. I mean, I would imagine in the series, is he quite as absurd as he is in the book?
Yeah,
I love Cathcart, I gotta be honest. I mean, when I heard you got Chandler for that, I was like, I've always loved him, but boy, oh boy, I can't wait. I can't wait to see what you put him through.
Yeah, the great thing about the stroke of genius in casting Kyle Chandler is is Coach from Friday Night Lights.
When I read that in the trades, I was like, oh, stop it. And I just laughed because I thought he must have had a heyday with that part.
Yeah, he's so great in it, kind of barking mad Colonel Cathcart. Yeah, and Kyle has the nicest face. Kyle is the nicest person. He has the sweetest face, and he's playing this barking lunatic, so out of touch with the reality of anything, and he's really a numbskull. And and Yossarian is so outraged that the numbskulls rule his life.
And that the logic of the numbskulls is such an enjoyable serpentine logic that's absolutely chasing its own tail, biting it, eating it, not being aware that it's being eaten. It's just wonderful.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that I love that you understand it's absurdity on top of absurdity, because I miss satire, absurdity. I miss irony a bit. I miss the less on the noseness of things and letting people, Billy Wilder was always so good at that, let them finish the equation. And I like what I'm sensing. You let people sort of decide to see, not tell them what this whole sort of ridiculous thing is as it correlates to what's happening today.
Yeah, I hope so. I hope that David and I we've tried to be subtle. Well, it's complex because on the one hand, you want to embrace the heightened comedy and the absurdity of the comedy. Mm-hmm. And on the other hand, you want to create a space in which you actually feel at more subtle levels the journey of anxiety of our hero, Yossarian, and some of his friends who die one by one each episode. It's a balancing act to get those things right, to not go too broad with the comedy so that you allow for a sort of smooth transition between the comedy and the darker, quieter moments. And I hope we've got that balancing act right. I've seen three of the finished episodes and I'm waiting for the other three. And so it's
I know you got to be positive here, but how do you feel about the three? Speak to the parts that you feel you really, became what you thought they would become. Can you speak to those?
It's a beautiful experience to watch complex solutions that David and I made to complex challenges that arose in the book, and to actually spend all these months and get them down in something resembling a scene that has a beginning, middle, and end and works properly. And then to see it, I was on set, so I was watching the stuff being shot, and then to see it come out the other end through the post-production process and go, oh my God, that scene works. It's a lovely moment. And the other thing is, of course, back in the day when Nichols made the film, they used about 18 or 20 B-25 bombers in that film, because in 1970, when they shot it, those planes were still operational. There are hardly any in the world now. We got hold of two and also a carcass, like a plane, one that didn't fly. And so we use that, we use those two for some of the aerial shots. And then there's a lot of CGI recreating planes. And then all the stuff that's inside the cockpit and the plane, the fuselage, we shot that at Cinecittà Studios in Rome. And so when that stuff all comes together with the special effects, the result is so deeply satisfying. The flak explosions and the terror and the fear and the panic. So that was a lovely thing for me.
Did you step back, and I know this is what the great benefit of those difficult days were, did you step back and could you really, can you really even now take in the enormous achievement of your life right now? Can you feel that? Can you take that in? Because it's rather amazing, Luke.
Yeah, I feel extraordinarily lucky, and that one little step at a time, these things, one thing led to another. You know, I came to America 12 years ago, and the first 6 years were very difficult and very poverty stricken. I couldn't get a meeting. I couldn't get representation. It was all really hard. And then the next few years weren't exactly easy. And then I began to crawl out of that hole. Lion did change a lot. The success of Lion and the way in which people love Lion started to make a real difference, in the sense that I could suddenly get indoors, into meetings, you know what I mean? And
you know, I'm going to tell you, Luke, it's not luck. It's not luck. You've earned this. You worked very hard for this. You stuck to it. You believed in that connection with who you really are. There's no luck here. You created every single moment of this. And
I've learned how to become a harder worker and a more disciplined worker.
I don't think that's ever been the problem.
I have defaults, you know. Default directions are always laziness and self-sabotage.
Oh yeah, but goodness gracious, you've taken Catch-22 and made it into a TV series. That is astounding. You know, it's so funny. I talk with people who achieve astounding things, and they say to me the same thing, of course, because you're in it. But remember, just please, this thing you've achieved is, it truly is astounding. It's rather spectacular.
I will remember.
Yeah, remember that, because this is just the beginning. This is just, the sky's the limit. You can do anything you want.
Touch wood, yes.
Isn't that lovely to know? It's lovely, right?
It is really lovely to know.
Yeah, and you're proving it right now. So I have to ask, simply because we're your life, because I find your connection to the larger part of you, this tenacity, this determination, really quite inspiring, and why the works you work on are so moving. Just from a bit of a emotional stance, like, how did you find the wherewithal to continue finding the confidence to work on something so large and such a large canvas? What was that internal wrestling you went through, in lieu of talking about the process, breaking down the scene, the structure, all that stuff? How did you find that within yourself?
It's that mixture of excitement, because somehow you got this job and you have to deliver this thing. And that's mixed in with fear and panic, because I don't know what I'm doing. I really, for a few months, in the first few months after I got the development deal with Catch-22 to deliver the pilot or the first episode and the Bible, the series outline, for the first few months, I really was thinking this is a catastrophe, because I'm going to fail, because I do not know how to take this novel apart and find a way into a TV series. So yeah, fear and panic was a real thing. But what I've found is that I have to counteract those kind of negative feelings with methodical small steps, with just having a timetable, showing up to work each day and attacking each small problem, one small problem at a time, and getting through the really difficult bits, the difficult days, the difficult weeks, by doing that, breaking it down into the smaller units. And then, of course, it's not always like that. There are those beautiful moments where you've solved some problems and you have an outline of an episode that feels like it makes sense. And where it really becomes beautiful for me is when that outline is very detailed, and when I'm actually sitting down with a blank page to write this scene or that scene.
You know, it's beautiful. You may not even be aware of it, but you just took the way in which you got through the worst days of your addiction and how you got through that and laid it over the framework of how you got through Catch-22.
Yeah, I'm not unaware of the link between the two things, between a way that I survived a thing that I might not otherwise have survived, and a way in which I have found a method of working that works for me.
Were you going to say shouldn't have?
Yeah, I mean...
Yeah, you were going to say shouldn't have. Are you kidding me? No, you were supposed to survive that for a reason.
Yeah, I believe that now. I do believe that now. Yes.
I do too. And that the reason is, and try to take this in, because, you know, I know you probably don't hear this a lot because of all the other smoke and mirrors around the show, but that is the livelihood, the lifeblood, I'm going to tell you with a great educated guess, that is going to soar through the series. Yeah.
Well, I hope you're right. I'm very looking forward to seeing how it lands in the world.
Yeah, that's a lovely thing to put out into the world. So you should feel very good about that. Yeah, really good.
Thanks, yeah. Mike. I do.
Good, good. Is there anything that you want to add? Because, you know, I take great pride in not belaboring these things so that you don't feel like you're not being heard. I want you to feel heard. I want you to say things you don't get to say on these endless series of the same questions. I find that kind of boring.
Thanks for not asking those kind of questions. I appreciate
it. Oh, God, no. I respect you far too much as an artist. Plus, that would just bore you. Is there anything that you want to add that simply no one is coming to you about this project?
No, there's not. You've taken this interview down a very interesting and unusual path, and I appreciate it. And it doesn't feel to me like, oh, I must talk about this or I must talk about that.
Good.
We spoke about more existential matters, and that's been pleasant.
Yes, and I'm glad you enjoyed that, because the existential unfettered optimism that is your spirit is clear in all the work that I've seen of yours. And it's really beautiful to know that the work that you're doing is being put out into the world. And I'm absurdly excited.
Oh, good.
It's going to be a wonderful ride for you ahead. And you deserve it all. You really do. You deserve everything.
Thanks, Mike. I really appreciate it. And it's great talking to you.
Same here. You have a lovely rest of your day.
Thank you, Michael C. Bryan. And thank you, Luke Davies. Thank you to all of our subscribers, and thanks to everyone who's been leaving us all those ratings and reviews on iTunes. You can stay in the know by following us on Facebook or find us on Twitter as @FinalDraftInc. And we're on Instagram as @FinalDraftScreenwriting. I'm Pete D'Alessandro. Until next time, write on.